How's it going, everybody? RazingHel here, and welcome back to another episode of Stronghold Legends Steam Edition. Today we are starting the Evil Campaign, and we're starting with chapter number one, Revenge.
Ah, Wallachia. If only your history was as clear and beautiful as the blue crystalline waters of the Danube that run beside your borders. But these lands have for too long been subjected to the tyrannous whims of Hungarian and Turkish empires. To think that our once great leader, Vlad II, Dracula, should pay tribute to Turkey by sending his two sons, Vlad and Radu, to live as nothing more than prisoners in the Sultan's palace. So, the father condemns the sons, and in turn, condemns himself, for Vladislav II, a Hungarian puppet, now sits on the throne. But it is time for one son to rise as a man, avenge the father, and bring the name of Dracula back to Wallachian soil.
Those skinny Wallachian runts were nothing more than sniveling babies when they came to us. Still, no one survives the Sultan's dungeons without toughening up a little. There are sights down there that could turn even my stomach. But the Sultan took a shine to the two boys and even allowed them free roam of the palace. I myself trained them in the Sultan's elite guard. They've become fine young men, and as fearless as any Turkish fighter. Now, you must help Vlad prove himself on the battlefield, for he is to head up a small army bound for Wallachia to unseat that bloated Hungarian idiot from the throne.
Okay, let's start this. We're going to be playing it on the very hard, or the hardest difficulty.
Sire, we have arrived at the castle. It has not been well built by its Hungarian ruler, but the Sultan is giving us only a small force with which to take it. We will need to use our troops.
Okay, so one thing that should be noted right here. So I start off with this army, and there are some archers loitering around over here that I'm going to be using my lord to take care of, because they can actually deal a lot of damage to my lord if I do not pay attention to them. And then I just sort of forget that they're there and they just keep shooting at my lord. So the purpose of the lord in this mission is going to actually be distracting the mangonels. And the lord is generally quite exceptional at doing this. But, well, for pretty obvious reasons, he doesn't take the fall damage. If a stone hits him, he's not going to get knocked back. Of course, you'll lose his horse, but right there you can see we're doing pretty good. Got the mangonels firing at him rather than at my siege equipment here, so that's always a good thing. And so I'm approaching with the stake hurlers, and right there got rid of one mangonel already, and then get rid of some of these archers as well. Stake hurlers are generally pretty strong against troops like this. They're not so strong against siege equipment, but... as you can see, I'm going to be clearing the walls, essentially, with the stake hurlers and those siege towers there. One thing you have to be careful about in this mission is actually staying out of range of the stake hurlers that are on that mountain next to the keep. There's sort of a little bluff up there, so you always have to keep that in mind. Stake hurlers are also pretty good at firing over walls because they fire with an arch trajectory. So unlike a ballista, they can actually get their stakes right over the walls and hit troops that are on the other side. Now, this scenario has actually been changed for the Steam edition of Stronghold Legends. Originally, it was significantly easier to siege this castle. One of the biggest improvements that have been made is the fact that there are oil burners, whatever they call those things, on the walls of this castle. Originally, there weren't any. So I got rid of the second mangonel like that, with the stake hurlers. Now I just have to get rid of some of the archers on that engine tower as well. Get rid of this, what do they call those? Those magic orb throwers. And then you can knock off some of the troops that are on the walls as well. Another aspect of this mission that has been changed for the Steam edition of Stronghold Legends in regards to difficulty is the second part of this mission, where you actually have to defend. The attacks that come at you are much more powerful, and they come at you a lot quicker. So right there's my lord under attack once again, taking archer fire and mangonel fire. Not always the best thing. Like, those arrows do add up, which is why I'm not going to bother moving my my cats, those protective shields, into place. I just moved the ballistas there right away. And then getting rid of those magic orb things, and got the mangonel off the engine tower. So everything's looking pretty good. So it's a very gradual process. Obviously, as you can see, the stake hurlers are my next big problem that I'm going to have to deal with. In case you're wondering about what's going on with this episode and this audio, I speeded it up to twice as fast because originally I was playing it. I mean, this part of the mission, this original siege mission, it took me around 20 minutes to play, and I was playing it at 90 speed. So as you can see, it's a lot of nonsense, really. Now here I'm lowering the speed to 10 so I can spawn down my werewolves. Unfortunately, it's very difficult to control the werewolves if you don't play it on the slowest speed. And that werewolf right there gets nailed by some stakes and killed. The objective here was, of course, to actually remove those stake hurlers that are on the mountain. I largely succeeded in my objective. One other time when I played through this, I was actually able to get all of these stake hurlers, but in this episode or in this playthrough of it, I only managed to get all but one of them. My werewolves died too easily before they could get that final stake hurdler, which is not especially a big problem because it is the one that's nearest to me, so I can get rid of it with my stake hurdlers without taking very much of any damage from the keep, the archers in the keep. And there is my lord just moving out of range of the keep as well. So as you can tell, it's actually quite beneficial to just focus on dealing with this right there. Got the final stake hurdler. Dealing with the siege with just the stake hurdlers. They're very effective. Moving the stake hurdlers once again within range. Cats as well. Apparently I moved them too close within range and I lost a cat there. And when I say cat, that's what those shields are called. And for those who are not aware, I'm not using the abbreviation for catapult. I know it's somewhat confusing because a lot of fans of the game will call catapults cats. So it's rather confusing to have a catapult and then a shield named a cat as well. I've never heard of cat used in the context of a shield, but it's certainly possible. Like, I'm not all that familiar with medieval siege equipment at the end of the day, I guess. So I got one ladder on the wall over there. Apparently it baited a lot of the macemen out, and I used my tower full of archers as well as those men-at-arms to deal with them pretty quickly. The men-at-arms are generally guarding the tower to help ensure that nothing happens, but you gotta keep those men-at-arms out of range of the oil smelters, those oil dumpers. I forget what they call them. The oil troughs that are on the walls, which might, it's actually beneficial to not set them to defensive or aggressive because that can lead to them actually triggering those oil tippers that are on the walls. So here I took my lord, ran in, because I already captured the gate with one of my men-at-arms, ran in and sent him over there to actually take care of those stake hurdlers on the other side of that river there. Works quite well at doing that because, once again, you know, very fast with a horse. We had plenty of honor to deal with that. I mean, we have 20 honor left, as a matter of fact, as it stands. And he can't get knocked back by being hit by the stake hurdler. So that's a very powerful ability of knights. So here we got all of the archers out of the towers, got them onto the walls. Got the archers out of the siege tower, I should say, and got them into the towers on the walls. And then we're just going to advance along here, remove some of the pikemen and macemen and whatnot, using the spearmen or the men-at-arms, whichever you prefer, as a meat shield, and the archers as a backup, sort of providing suppressive fire. It's ultimately faster than targeting them one by one with the stake hurdlers. And get rid of these swordsmen ultimately as well, just surround them sort of. And now we can actually start moving the men-at-arms up to start capturing the keep along with the archers. The more units you have in the keep, the faster you capture it. So right there is the first part of this mission done. Victory. Unfortunately, this is a two-part episode, which means we have another 35 minutes or so to go.
The times are strange indeed. For no sooner had young Vlad seized the throne of Wallachia when he was unseated 2 months later by General Hunyadi and the Hungarian army. They placed Vladislav II back in control and sent Vlad into exile. But people can change sides in the blink of an eye, and those in power are easily swayed by the thought of more power. The Sultan of Turkey was so relentless in his courting of Vladislav II that to Hungary it seemed as if their puppet had broken its strings. The only option was to turn to Vlad, and with Hunyadi's help, the young Wallachian prince seized back the throne, this time with Hungary's blessing.
Traitorous Vladislav! I should have known that the fat fool couldn't be trusted with a bucket of pig's wheel, let alone a crown! At least now we have someone in charge who is loyal to Wallachia! Vlad was simply using Turkish forces to gain his father's throne back, and if what he tells me of the Sultan's prisons is to be believed, I think he would rather die than let it fall into Turkish hands. Vlad has even adopted the name of his father, Vlad Dracul, and has joined the sacred knights of the Order of the Dragon. But now he has pulled the dog's tail, he must face its bite. General Bashir and the Turkish army are on the move, and heading this way.
So you may or may not have noticed there, but I had an issue with my audio, so I had to restart. I apologize for that, and hopefully this turns out better. So what we're doing here is I'm going to be building up the economy that I need to sustain the attacks that are going to be thrown at me, placing the granary as per usual, and we're going to be using dairy chicken farms because they have a great combination of speed, very fast to get up and going, and they also produce a fair amount of food for the amount of land that they require. Overall, the forest gets in the way there a little bit, but we'll be clearing some of that out with these wood camps that I'm placing now. And then I'm also going to be buying more wood. One thing you'll notice about this chapter is that since the rebalance from Stronghold Legends Steam Edition, you start the episode with a whole lot more gold than you formerly did. I think you used to start with about 4,000, and now you start with around 11,000. So the amount of gold was increased quite significantly, which is actually quite proportionate to the size of the attacks that were also increased. You're going to be hit much harder to begin with right away than you formerly were. So overall, I think it was a pretty decent rebalance, and I'm not really complaining about it, but it was interesting that Firefly would choose to actually rebalance this one mission. Like, apparently they considered it really, really broken in terms of relative difficulty. So what I did there was I deleted the wall that used to surround my keep, because I'm going to be using the magic orb launchers. And if I want to use them, essentially what the magic orb launchers do, of course, is they roll out a ball across the ground, and any troops that are in its path will get knocked over, like bowled over, and it provides that same knockback effect that, for example, the stake hurler causes. I'm also deleting the stairs here, which turns out, as you'll see, to be later a mistake on my part. But the idea with the magic orbs is that I will easily take care of a lot of the enemy's forces this way without actually needing like archers or spearmen, because we don't have a whole lot of variety in terms of the actual military units we can recruit. So we're going to be relying more on siege units than actual barracks like units. I also have to delete the wall that I just built because I accidentally trapped some of my siege equipment outside. They hadn't actually got all the way inside the keep, the castle yet, so it's just one of those things, isn't it? So I recruited around about 15 of the magic orb launchers, and I'm going to be sending them up top right next to the keep. So they're going to be on that wall, that bluff, that mountain, overlooking the rest of the land here. And I'll get them into position. I'll spread them out, make sure that they have pretty decent coverage of the area, so that way they will do as much damage as possible across the attacks that are sent in from both the south and the east. The southeast, not so much. Like, I left the engine tower there because, in general, I think it is better to have something like that for the trebuchets to shoot at rather than actually delete it and then force the trebuchets that will come in the attacks to actually target something, a tower that's more valuable to me. Like that tower there in the corner, the southeast corner, does not impact the defenses of my keep here in any way, really. It just serves as a distraction. So, as you can see, the magic orb launchers are now in place, and I'm spreading them out. Some of them look like they defy the laws of physics, the laws of gravity, the way they're tilted there on the side of that hill. And they do take a little bit of time to set up here. Like, you have to go through each and every one of them and make them target a location. But once you have that done, they'll continue targeting that location until you tell them to stop or until they get killed. So overall, it really doesn't take that much time aside from the initial prep. And they do a lot of damage. They are worth it if you can get them set up. Interestingly enough, while the mission change actually got rid of one of my siege towers, they kept the ladderman, even though I don't need to use ladderman either. So why would you get rid of the siege tower but let me keep the ladderman? I'm not sure. Could have to do with the fact that the siege tower you can actually station. It can essentially function as a mobile tower, whereas laddermen are pretty much useless. So there are only a total of 4 different troops in this scenario that are capable of being recruited. 2 of them are from the siege camps, in other words, the stake hurlers and these magic orb launchers. And then the other 2 are archers and men-at-arms from the barracks. Which is why, you know, I was sort of left with a quandary. I was left with an undesirable decision to make here, because either you have to focus on archers the entire way, just spam them out, or we can actually focus on building more siege equipment And I've seen other people use archers, but that was before the Steam Edition rolled around, so I wasn't sure how that would work out, and I decided, let's just try something different. Not many people use the magic orb launchers, let's go for that and see what happens. And overall, I think it worked out quite nicely. I'm not sure exactly why it's taking me so long to launch that orb there. I think I was waiting to time it in with the other ones, yeah. That would appear to be the case. So the first attack is coming in, and as you can see, it's not even like a quarter done. So you're under attack very, very early in this map, which is why I played on such an exceedingly low speed. And I decided, yeah, we're going to get my lord out there, and he's going to take care of that trebuchet, right? How the bad wall event all began, essentially, because, I mean, we're playing at a pretty low speed here. Imagine this. This footage here is speeded up. This is twice the rate that it was originally recorded at. And you could say that says a lot about how terrible I am at micromanaging a game, a real-time strategy game, which is probably true. But at the same time, it just, to me, it means that the game was not actually balanced for play on, or for playback on the standard 40 speed. Like, the game should be capable of being played on the default speed, and it really wasn't. And you always have to be careful about the macemen that are surrounding the tower, if surrounding the siege camp. If they don't leave, make sure that you don't send your lord out there next to them, because the macemen are actually faster, I believe, than the lord himself. And they can tear your horse out from under you as you're running away. Now, the trebuchet is targeting that southeastern bastion tower, or engine tower. I always call them bastion towers. I never seem to get engine tower right. By and large, it's targeting that tower, so hopefully it defers any damage that would normally be caused to my actual ballistas. What are they called? Yeah, you can see my lord is now on the tower walls because of all those ladders. That's a good point to make, is why bother deleting the steps when you know they're just going to spam ladders all over it anyway? It pretty much defeats the purpose of it. You might as well just let the laddermen run rampant all over your stuff anyway, because they're going to do it one way or the other, because there's just really no limit on them. So I knocked a whole bunch of ladders off there with the men-at-arms after I got them on the walls, but there was still a ladder apparently for my lord to get up on. Or maybe that was actually in a different attack. I'm not entirely certain here. Should have used the oil tipper there, obviously, but I failed to, and then one catapult hit later, it was entirely gone. So that was a missed opportunity, I guess you could say. And a lot of my men-at-arms are getting wasted by that catapult that I can't target with my spear. My spear throwers, they're called what? I forget. I'm just so scatterbrained right now. It's largely because I had to re-record this again. My audio interface failed. Like, it was a 45-minute recording, and all of a sudden, 10 minutes into it, it's already unbearably grainy sounding. I've recently been having this problem with my new audio interface. It could just, maybe I just need to restart my computer. Probably going to try that next. But this is definitely not something I'm going to be willing to put up with, where I have to re-record things again and again because the audio sounds like crap. It really is baffling too, because theoretically the interface that I have is supposed to be a professional interface, so why is it acting up like that? But now you can see, as I mentioned, my lord is actually on the wall there, and I can't get him off because there are no stairs around that section of the wall. It's damaged, so I can't move him into the tower, and the enemy swordsman is too close for me to build stairs. So I'm essentially trapped there on the wall with my lord, which is never a good position to be in. You don't want to be in a position like that. And there's nothing to fire at that swordsman. The swordsman essentially has free reign of the area. Like, there are no archers within range. Can't hit him with my stake hurdlers, and my magic orbs are not going to hit him either. So, you know, what do? You just got to wait for him to walk out of the way, which is, like I said, not a position you really want to find yourself in, especially when it's your lord that's trapped up there, and losing your lord results in you losing the mission. So could I have played it on a faster difficulty, faster speed? Yes. Yes, I could have. But this was a significantly larger attack than what I was used to. Like, I've played through this mission before the Steam Edition was released, and the mission is considerably easier. So if you're watching a different playthrough of this, eventually the swordsman got out of the way and I was able to delete the wall from underneath my lord. If you're watching an older playthrough of this, though, it's not going to be up to date for the Steam Edition, so just remember there are discrepancies there. And keep that in mind, that your experience is not going to match what the old experience of playing this mission was. So it does bug me that I deleted the stairs and then I couldn't rebuild them. I built a gatehouse there, obviously, but I couldn't rebuild the stairs because, once again, you're just attacked incessantly. You're not really given much of a breather until about halfway through. And then there are a whole bunch of those boatmen, the Pictish boat warriors. They were a carryover from Stronghold 2. If you recall, you could actually recruit them from the mercenary post. Here I'm building some stone quarries, so it would be nice to have some stone to build defenses such as towers, gatehouses, and at the same time I can sell the access. Mostly it's just for selling the access so I can continue to recruit units. But you might remember the Pictish boat warriors. They were available in the mercenary post in Stronghold 2. They are available in Stronghold Legends as well, but you cannot as a player recruit them. They're only possible to access in the scenario editor. So you actually have to edit them into a scenario for them to appear. And you can give them to the player, obviously, but the player is not capable of recruiting them naturally, I guess you could call it. But yeah, I wanted to mention about the audio. Like, audio was something I prided myself on. I wanted to get it good. I don't like listening to bad audio, and then it just really disappoints me when the same happens to me. And like, I can't tell if this is going to be bad audio as well. It just happens randomly right in the middle of a recording. Like, I did an audio test. I wanted to make sure the audio sounded fine, and it did. But then once I was about 8 minutes in, all of a sudden it started going to hell. And I'm not exactly sure how to correct that. So that's just more heartache, more trouble that I have to hunt down, troubleshoot. Might just go back to the old audio interface. Fortunately, I didn't get rid of it. So we'll see if that works. If a simple restart does not fix this problem with this supposedly professional audio interface, then we're just going to go back to the old one. The old one wasn't bad, but I do much prefer the new one, given the amount of routing options you get. It's really nice when you have multiple channels of audio and you want to record them separately. But here we go. Putting some ox tethers down around the stone quarries to transport the stone to the stockpile, obviously. Unlike Stronghold 2 and pretty much every other Stronghold before it, Stronghold Legends was quite innovative in the fact that you don't actually require a peasant to man the ox tether, which essentially makes them spammable in a way. But I don't think it actually negatively affected the gameplay or the balance of the gameplay in any way. We're being hit with two more attacks from the southern side of the map. Pretty big deal. Like I said, you're not really given much of a break until around about half of this mission is complete, and we're not quite there yet. So with the fact that you're not really given a break until about halfway through the mission leads me to believe that they only half balanced it. Like, they spent the time going through half the mission, made it really hard, but then for the last half, they just sort of got lazy on it and actually didn't ramp up the difficulty at all and just kept it at its default. The stake hurlers are interesting in the fact that they're not very efficient against the other siege equipment. You have to have a lot of them. Like, I have about 20, and I have them all grouped up so that way I eventually can just target one of the enemy's siege equipment, like the catapult or the stake hurler of theirs, and it'll bring them all down. It'll bring it down immediately. But I mean, 20 stake hurlers to do that, it's pretty extreme. I mean, 20 archers would probably have about the same effect on it. So yeah, stake hurler is not all that effective against siege equipment. You're really better off using archers to do it. But the magic orbs are very effective against especially armored troops. I don't have any anti-armor units here, so having the magic orbs really helped with that. And as you can see, also I got my bow production up and going. You have currently 7 Fletchers making bows, producing them, putting them in the armory. I can't actually buy bows in this scenario, otherwise I would have done that. And I also opened up this southern side, the southern wall here, put a gatehouse in. That way I can sally forth with my lord. It's a much better solution than what I had before, and I can actually put a nice little stairs on there in case the enemy gets their ladderman on top of it. You can easily push them off without being locked on top of the wall like a noobishly dib on the eastern wall. I'm also building a couple of these small towers here, these small turrets, just to put a few archers in. Overall, they don't hold many archers. It would have been nicer to have one of the engine towers, but these are the only towers that you're given as an option to build, which is kind of funny because these are all good buildings and we are playing the evil campaign. We're playing Vlad and he's evil. So why does he have good buildings? It's beyond me. I guess he hasn't turned evil yet. I might have forgotten actually that part of the campaign where he goes a little bit more evil than he originally was. I mean, he was already putting the enemy's heads on stakes and stuff, but I guess that's not quite the same as dabbling in the dark arts, is it? Or recruiting werewolves. This was rather interesting to me, these pitch rigs here. For some reason, they couldn't access the stockpile. It really didn't make any sense to me if there was a tree perhaps blocking the way. Ultimately, I just ended up deleting it because most of the reason I was building pitch rigs anyway was to produce pitch for selling. It wasn't that very critical. But then I also built a market here so that we can auto-sell stone. Pretty much auto-sell everything that we're not going to need much of. And that way I don't have to bother selling it. I can focus actually on the battles themselves rather than having to get bogged down with micromanaging the economy. I was a big fan of the auto market that was first introduced in Stronghold Legends, believe it or not. Back 1 year prior with Stronghold 2, still didn't have an auto market. You had to do these click spamming whenever you wanted to sell something. So yeah, you hear the message, your stockpile is full, and right in the middle of a siege, well, you better prepare to jump back over to your castle and start selling, or else risk not having enough room for more important goods. Like if your stockpile is full of wood and you need it to store, for example, wheat, because that's a food type, and you can't because the stockpile is full of wood. And that means that eventually your bakers won't have any flour, and that means that your entire food production chain can sort of fall apart. If this doesn't turn out once again, if the audio turns out crap here, I'm really sorry, but I'm not going to be redoing it another time. That's just outrageous. We are doing another attack here, though. I had to reload this one because I accidentally started moving all of my magic orb launchers. So that's something to keep in mind when you're actually playing this. Make sure that you have your stake hurdlers keyed to one number, like control one. You can link it to that number, that hotkey. And then make sure that whenever you select your stake hurlers, you're not actually going to end up moving the magic orb launchers as well. Because if you move the magic orb launchers right there, you're going to have to reset all of those commands to tell them to send their balls rolling out, essentially. So this attack here is probably one of the bigger ones. Like, next to the final assault, this is really, really big. We're seeing a lot of siege towers here now instead of ladders. But for me, that doesn't matter much because I don't really have any problem with laddermen at this point in the game. Laddermen can go on the walls, but we're getting archers out of the barracks, and we're going to be using those archers to clear the laddermen off the walls. I don't know if you really noticed the carnage that the magic orbs are causing, but they do a good job, especially against armored units when you don't have any counters, any natural counters. Now, archers will naturally prioritize knocking ladders off the walls before firing, which is actually important because otherwise what would happen is as long as there was an enemy within range, the ladders would never be dealt with. But as it stands, archers are more than capable of getting units off the walls. There was also a rogue maceman that managed to get up the ladder. Macemen are very fast, so keep an eye out for them. One managed to get into my keep area, and they destroyed my siege camp, quite unfortunately. So, yeah, that was something that I could have prevented, but unfortunately it didn't happen. overall, I find the stake hurlers a more situational defensive unit than the magic orb launchers, because it's not as easy to set them up to blanket an area. You could do it, but the overall impact it's going to have is nowhere near as effect or great as the orb launchers, because the orb launchers, the ball rolls out from them, and so they're going to be taking out any troops in its path that pretty much extends halfway through my defensive range, I guess you could call it. And since they're up in that mountain there with my keep, it's not like I'm going to be losing any of them to enemy units. I mean, even archers have tried firing on them and really haven't caused any significant amount of damage to them. So overall, they're a great unit if you have the right terrain for it. Like, obviously, you're not going to be able to place it behind castle walls, because if the balls roll into a castle wall, it's going to act like a catapult. It's going to destroy the wall. And so they're a very situational defensive unit, and it's nice that the scenario was set up to use them. And I think that with the rebalancing, they became a much more attractive option than before. I've added a couple more here to my overall armada of them. I'm not sure you can say an armada of siege equipment, but that's what I'm using, so get used to it. Remember to save frequently in missions like this. I mean, obviously, with it being rebalanced, it is significantly more difficult to play through than it originally was. So even though this is the first mission of the evil campaign is the hardest, so it's essentially like we're starting out probably at midway of the ice campaign. It's interesting because I've heard people say, like, who are fans of the campaigns, that the ice campaign was more difficult than the evil one, but I don't think I necessarily agree, especially now that it's been rebalanced. I think this is at least on par with a lot of the ice mission ones. I mean, obviously, I don't think I felt really in danger here of actually losing my army or my keep, aside from the time when I ran out there quite carelessly with my lord. I generally like using my lord for just about everything, and this is actually a character flaw, because your lord is not as powerful as he at first seems. Like, if you get a whole bunch of units to gang up on him, he's done for. And in general, the enemy tends to have a lot of units that can gang up on him, especially macemen. Always be very careful around macemen, because they're faster than you, so they can catch up to you and tear your horse out from underneath your very feet. So we're finally dealing with the final attack here. So there's two attacks at one time coming from the south and the east. So basically both sides of my castle there. They're going to be big attacks. They're going to have trebuchets. And they're eventually going to destroy that one southeastern engine tower that I mentioned. I decided to throw some more pitch out there, but in general, I don't like pitch. You may or may not have noticed. I think pitch is a little bit too high maintenance. You really have to be on the ball with it all the time if you actually want to use it effectively. And in general, I'm not that kind of player. Not the kind of player who likes having to refill the defenses every single time. If there was a button that allowed me to replenish all the pitch ditches after the attack was over, I think I might use them more. But as it stands, you actually have to manually place them down one at a time. And that becomes very tedious to me, especially when there are all our alternative means of defense that are made available to the player, such as oil tippers on the walls, plenty of the siege equipment that can be defensive. And then there are also, like, heroes, if you're playing Arthur, that are quite exceptional at defense. Sir Percival, of course, comes to mind first and foremost. And, wow, it is a pretty hectic battle. What can you say? Overall, I think that the archers did not do the majority of the damage here. My engine tower is down. Most of the damage is coming from the magical orbs at this point, despite the fact that I have a lot of archers there in the towers, which is why I went with them. Decided to place another little tower there because I was afraid that with the engine tower down in the southeast corner that they would actually start targeting my other engine towers with archers on them. And I'm not exactly sure if placing a small tower to the inside of an engine tower would prioritize combat for that or targeting for that, but yeah, who knows. So I tried baiting the macemen there with my lord, you may have noticed. We got one siege tower on the walls here, but the archers will make short work of that, believe it or not.
And then I can get the stake hurlers to take care of these other two siege equipment. They can just rip right through them now that I have about 22 of them or whatever. But I tried baiting those mace men. Didn't work because the mace men are being a real pain in the ass, to be honest. That's what they're doing here. And they're guarding that camp. And I can't get past it. And I mean, there are too many of them for me to take on by myself. I keep trying to bait them out, but they keep running back to the camp before my archers can kill them off. They're very fast, so it's difficult for my archers to draw a bead on them. And you can see they just all run right back to the camp again to defend it. So I can't get rid of the trebuchet. I wanted to get rid of the trebuchet with my lord. And he ends up getting stuck here, lost his horse, because one of my magic orbs rolled over him. Took about half his health, so that was probably the closest I got to dying on this one. It really was a sticky situation, and something you need to keep in mind when you're actually playing this one is that both the stake hurlers and the magic orbs can hurt your own unit, so make sure you keep your units out of range of those defenses. But on this side, on the south side, the macemen had already left. Well, there's one left. There's one left guarding it. So I was able to spawn down my werewolves, and the werewolves got rid of the trebuchet. So we're very close to being done here. And werewolves got rid of the camp. And now I just have to select my lord and send him over to the easternmost camp once again. He's going to be running very fast over there. Unfortunately, those damn macemen are still there. And they're going to go after my lord. Of course they are. Why wouldn't they? So I tried to lead him over here. I thought, yeah, well, the archers will be able to take care of him. Nope. Archers can't do jack about it because guess what? The macemen are too fast. The archers to draw a target on them. So my lord is about down to 25% health now. I finally got rid of that trebuchet. So you could say the AI gave me a run for my money here, because I didn't want the trebuchet to deal any more damage to my castle than it already was. I mean, obviously I could have stopped being selfish and just allowed the attack to play out. There wasn't much left and I was obviously going to win it. But here I felt that there was a need for me to essentially throw it all away in a desperate bid to get rid of that trebuchet, because it really bothered me. I hate being shelled by trebuchets, but it got done. I didn't lose my lord, so that is victory. After around about, I'd say an hour and 10 minutes, overall it took me that long, but I sped it up here.
The Turkish army was sprawling and numerous, but Vlad Dracul held out against them.
For brevity.
When the arrived the next morning, they were not prepared for the sight that awaited them. 20,000 Turkish prisoners had been impaled on spikes outside the castle. No Turkish soldier would go near that gruesome forest of dead and dying men, and they returned home, frightened and demoralized.
But anyway, that pretty much concludes it for the first episode of the Evil Campaign. Thank you very much for watching, as always, and I hope to see you next time.